Let's do this. Let's go before the Lord and let's ask His Holy Spirit to speak to each and every one of us. Because I need prayer, you need prayer, we all need prayer. Amen. We can't get enough of that. So let's go before the Lord today. Would you join with me? Father, we come before you today, and Lord, we ask that you would fill our hearts with your word today, Lord, with your will. Lord, we don't come to hear from a man. Lord, we don't come for a social cause or for a ritual tradition. Lord, we come to hear from you. So, Lord, we ask today that it would be your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, Lord, out of your word, that we would see it, that we would recognize it, we would realize it. Lord, I pray that we would internalize it, we would take it home and be equipped and encouraged to do and to be who and what you've called us to be as your church, as your followers. And, Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. Lord, we ask that you would bless all the churches across the Inland Empire today that are meeting and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask that you would speak to them. Holy Spirit, move upon them as we ask that you would move upon us and speak to us and move through us in Jesus' mighty name. We all together said,
amen.
Amen. Well, if you've got your Bibles, go with me to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. So we continue our study in the book of Hebrews. And as you're turning to Hebrews, I'm going to ask you a question. I think most of you know the answer to it, or most of you relate to it. But have you ever been in that place in your life where you felt just totally overwhelmed, like just way overdone? And I don't mean like overwhelmed in a good way, like I'm overwhelmed by love or by joy. I'm not talking about that kind of overwhelmed. I'm talking about like the overwhelmed of like there are so many things coming at me from so many different angles, from so many different sides, from all different things that I just don't even know how to process it. I don't even know how to like respond to it. And you almost kind of go into that like mental shutdown of like, you know, staring off into a blank distance, like beep, leave a message after the tone. Nobody's here right now. Like I'm just going into my own little vacation world mentally. You ever been there before? You know, the world that we live in, especially in our culture today, or the world that we live in is very fast paced. There's a lot of things coming at us. I mean, think about just the amount of information that comes at us on a daily basis from all different directions, from all different sides. It gets difficult to process it. It gets difficult to understand it. It gets difficult to decipher how or what we should do with that. And then on top of that, you just add the pressures of life and how easily it is for us to get overwhelmed. I mean, think about it. Think about overwhelming as far as what it is to be a parent these days. It's overwhelming to try to raise a child in this day and age and keep them away from the temptations of the world, try to keep them away from things like drugs and alcohol, and just to try to raise a good human being. It can be overwhelming. In our relationships, you know, our connections with family members, it's overwhelming sometimes because there's just always that constant tension. There's always that pressure within your marriages, you know, husbands and wives. I remember one person told me they just got married and they thought, you know, man, I didn't know that marriage would be this much work. And it's like, yeah, we all get this image of like marriage is the notebook. Like as soon as two lovebirds find each other, that it's like roses and honeymoons all the rest of your life. It's work and it can get overwhelming. And then on top of that, you start to add things like financial pressure to make ends meet, to keep the bills going, to put food on the table, to keep the electricity going, you know, all the different things that are happening. On top of that, then we have to add the pressure that we put upon ourselves with social media to make sure that we present our lives in a way that everybody else wants to live our life. And we try to look that good. You know, there's a pressure in that to have the highlight reel of our life look good on social media. And there's all these types of different pressures that can get overwhelming to the place where you just say to yourself, I just don't know if I can do it anymore. Anybody ever been there before? I just don't know if I can do it anymore. How about this one? How about in our faith? I mean, think about it. Think about what is it? Our faith is believing in something that we don't see, believing that an outcome that we don't see is going to happen somewhere in our lives. I mean, it can wear somebody down in a sense with the pressures that come at us to say, you know, things are happening and I don't understand why they're happening this way. Things are going on or things are not doing the way I thought or the way I believed or the way the pastor said that they would go. And I just don't understand. And I have this faith of things that I don't see, but I just don't know how long I can hold on anymore. Has anybody ever been there? If we're honest, I think we've all been there at some place in our point in our lives. You know, the nice thing to know about this, if there's anything that you know or want to know, is that the nice thing to know is that you're not alone in that. Whether you're in that moment right now, whether you've been there before, or whether you're looking at a season coming up and you just don't quite know how you're going to handle it, you're not alone. You see, the world is full of people that throughout the course of their lives have been overwhelmed by a great many things. And as we study the book of Hebrews, line upon line, precept upon precepts, as we say it, the book of Hebrews contextually is written. The book of Hebrews is a letter to Hebrew believers, we believe, and we'll see that in Romans, the 13th chapter, believe to people in Rome who were Hebrew believers. And it's a letter written to them because they were dealing with exactly that same thought I don't know if I can do this anymore. I don't know if I can handle this anymore. I don't know if I can continue at this pace anymore. You see, they were tempted by all means, because of persecutions, because of hardships, because of what was coming at them from all the different directions in life. They were tempted to go back from their belief in Jesus, back to their system of religion, because it was comfortable, because it was easy, because it was something that they were used to in life. They were asking themselves at that very moment that this letter was written to them thousands of years ago, I'm just not sure I can make it anymore. And so now we find ourselves in Hebrews, the 12th chapter. In Hebrews, I believe Hebrews chapter 11 and 12 and 13, of the last three chapters, are really like the tip of the iceberg. The culmination of everything that Hebrews has been written about is all about these chapters, basically telling us, look, there are people that have gone before us that have exercised their faith. They've stepped out. They didn't know what they were doing. They didn't know what was going on, but yet they lived in faith and they pleased God. Having seen that, we saw that there were people that they stepped out in faith and they didn't even see their promises come to pass, but yet they still trusted in God. Then after that, it says, listen, you and I, we're like great athletes running a race. Don't give up. Lay aside the weights and the sin that so easily keep us back and keep running, the Bible says in verse number one, with endurance, what? The race set before us. And then it tells us that we keep our eyes, our gaze, our fix focused on Jesus, who did the exact same thing before us, who for the joy set before him, despising shame, endured the cross. And so we see that. And we talk about, then they went and talked about persecution. You have not yet found the hardships in your life to the point where you've died because of them. So don't give up. And then it brings to us this letter. And to them, the believers at the time, sometimes in life we get off course. Sometimes in life we take the wrong steps. And in order for God to bring us to the place that God wants to bring us, what does he do? He brings corrective action in our lives. In godly discipline, not punishment. We learned all the difference about that. And so here now we find ourselves in Hebrews in the 12th chapter. And today I want to take a look at just a couple of short words in verse number 12 of the 12th chapter. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 12. Therefore, predicated, built upon, it says in the very beginning, built upon everything that we've already discussed, the hall of faith, the imagery of don't run, or don't give up on running your race. Don't despise the fact that God will lead you in corrective action to the place he wants you to be. Because of all of that, therefore, he says, strengthen the hands that hang low and the feeble knees. Strengthen the hands that hang low and the feeble knees. And the writer of this letter is quoting out of the book of Isaiah. And he's painting this picture. And many believe that this is tied back into the imagery of running the race. And you think about running the race, if you've ever been involved in a race, or you've ever been involved in an activity that was exerting for an extended amount of time, you know that it gets exhausting after a while. And so here it talks about running the race with endurance. And so there's this image of somebody running the race and they're physically exhausted. The hands that hang low, there's no more energy anymore. The knees that can't continue or to bear the weight of what's going on. There's an imagery of an exhausted athlete running the race. And he says in this letter, an encouragement to the churches, listen, strengthen those weak hands. Some translations say to lift your weak hands and gird about or strengthen your knees. You see, your arms, you think about arms. Arms are a symbol of strength, of the ability to have that strength. It's our livelihood, or our hands and the knees. The knees are the legs are the strongest muscles in the body. They are the significance to bear the weights of heavy loads. If you ever worked a job where you had to lift things for a living, they always would tell you, don't lift with your back, right? Lift with your legs or bend with your knees, right? Maybe you say, I didn't know that. That's why your back hurts. And so your legs signify the ability to bear the loads, and your arms signify the strength that we have. And so this is an encouragement. It's an exhortation. Hey, don't give up. Don't stop. Listen, you might be exhausted. You might be running that race feeling like there's nothing left in your gas tank. But he says, in the midst of all that, strengthen your arms. Lift them up. Boy, it's not your ability. Look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him did exactly the same thing. Strengthen the knees. There's a pressure on your life, a pressure in your marriage, a pressure on your finances, a pressure with your children, a pressure with your emotional status, whatever it might be. but strengthen your knees. Why? So you can carry the loads and the pressures of life. I see it like this, I believe, as the Holy Spirit impressed upon my heart this week as to what to communicate. I see it like this. It's a charge. It's a challenge. It's a call to you and to me, the followers of Jesus Christ, to be resilient in life. To be resilient. You see, what is resiliency? Resiliency is the ability to flex under pressure, to be able to bend and not break, to spring back after being pushed down. And so here is this imagery of this athlete that's tired saying, don't give up. Don't stop. Lift up your arms even though you don't think you can. Strengthen your knees even though you think you can't run anymore. Why? Keep going. Be resilient. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. Why? Because there's something greater ahead for you. And it's a charge. It's a challenge. It's an encouragement to us, the followers of Jesus Christ, much like it was thousands of years ago to the people reading this letter of Hebrews, to them, to not go back to what we once were, but to continue pressing in resiliency for what God has for each and every one of us. Resiliency is this imagery of strength. It's imagery of able to be able to handle what comes at us in life. And let me ask this question. What is it that builds strength? What is it that builds strength? Well, a couple of weeks ago, I finally connected with one of my friends here at the church, Brian Schultze. He's the head of our food distribution center, and he leads all of our outreach. Like you saw the turkey, him and Miss Mignon, they partner together, and they lead our FDC, or we call it our food distribution center. Brian, many years ago, Brian was overweight and unhappy with his life, and so he lost a lot of weight, and he got skinny, and he said, I don't want to be skinny and lanky, so Brian started going to the gym. Brian dedicated a lot of time in his life to the gym, and now Brian is very strong. As a matter of fact, I was teasing him about his chicken legs, and he wasn't here this morning, so I didn't do it for him, but now that he's not here, I can make fun of him. I was teasing him about his chicken legs, because I think he has chicken legs, and he sent me a video back of him leg squatting 1,200 pounds, and he's like, they might be chicken legs, but they can squat 1,200 pounds. I was like, all right. But then he texted me back, and he said, but who's counting? And I was like, all right, all right, all right. So I reached out to my friend Brian, and I said, Brian, O wise master, teach me your ways, because I, too, want to be strong. And he was like, well, what do you want? And I was like, Brian, can I just be honest with you? I said, I'm really not interested in, like, making a life change. I'm really not interested in, like, trying to get, like, all together. And, like, I said, there's a lot of stuff that's hidden under clothes, and I'm all right with that. I said, Brian, the truth of the matter is that I want to hold a microphone, and I want to look like Jared Reynolds. I just want people to see the gun show. I just want, you know, that bump on the bicep and the tricep. I said, Brian, if that's it, I'm cool, man. Everything else is hidden under a sweater or a clothes anyways. As long as my arms can look good, I'm good. And so what happened? Brian took me to the gym. We met up at the gym, and Brian said, all right, I'm going to teach you how to work your arms because that's what you want to do. And he gave me the lecture, you know, for all of those of you that are fitness experts, don't just work one part of the body. They're all connected together. But anyways, so we worked them out. And what did we do? We lifted weights. Right, we went to the gym and we worked on a bunch of different machines. And Brian's one of those guys, he doesn't believe in just working a muscle, but working a specific targeted area of the muscle. So you did certain exercises to work one part, and then you did certain exercises in a different position or different weights to work another part, and then you would transition and you do different phases of exercise to work the entire muscles all together. And I remember I'd been to the gym before, and I remember, you know, I'm gonna be sore for a couple of days, and that's good and that's great. But after about 2 days, I literally was Isaiah. Or it was Hebrews chapter 12, verse 12. Like, I couldn't even lift my arms anymore. I was walking into church, and all my friends were making fun of me because it was just like trying to push the door open. And I was like, trying to get out of bed in the morning. Stacy's laughing at me because I have to like roll out and then put my feet down because my arms were gone. There was nothing left in them. For about a week, I couldn't move my arms. And I was like, Brian, you got to chill out, man. But what builds strength? Well, on a cellular level, within the human body, when you face resistance, when you're pulling against a weight or when you're pushing against a weight, what happens on a cellular level is your muscles literally begin to tear, shred apart, and your body starts to inject proteins and different acids into those, and those cells, they begin to build upon each other. And so after what happens to that healing process, your body adds a little bit more mass to that, and it gets slightly stronger and slightly bigger, and then you repeat the process over and over and over again. Until finally you build strength in your body. So we understand this in the human element, in the physical world. What builds strength is resistance. It's resistance. I mean, think about it. Wouldn't you love to be able to take a magic little pill and to take that little pill and sit on the couch and binge watch Netflix all day long and gorge yourself on all the greasy junk food you possibly can and still get up and build strength while you do it. Like after 3 days of watching Netflix, get up and be like, oh, here I am. That's what we'd want to do, and everybody would invest in that if they could. Why? Because we seek after a comfortable life. When I ask the question, have you ever felt overwhelmed? Nobody wants to feel overwhelmed. Nobody wants to feel the position of pressure in their lives. Nobody wants to feel resistance in their relationships or resistance in their job, resistance in their faith. Nobody wants to go through those. Why? Because we want an easy life. We think to ourselves, listen, this life is short. I don't have a lot of time here. I don't want to deal with a lot of drama. I don't want to deal with a lot of issues. Let me just kind of do my thing. You do your thing. Let's all just get along and get by with this life. And so we seek after comfort in our lives, but we understand physically that in order for us to gain strength in our bodies, it takes resistance for our muscles to grow. Spiritually, it's the exact same principle. How do we gain strength? Resistance. Resistance in our lives. I think about it like this. When I was in our video and our tech departments, and now I oversee all of our wonderful tech crew, don't you guys just appreciate our unseen heroes of the church? Almost never see them. I remember the times of my life growing in understanding and growing in knowledge of designing things like screens and all these different things. I put these together. It wasn't the good times that I grew in that. It wasn't the times where everything was easy, when church services went exactly the way I wanted them to. Those weren't the times I grew. It was the times for me when things fell apart right before church service. And Pastor Jim would tell me, hey, church is starting in 20 minutes and you better get everything back online. You know, it was really neat this last week. One of my favorite people here, Missy, our sound woman extraordinaire. Everybody look back at the sound booth and give Missy a big fist pump. Go, girl. Missy and the magic bun. And Missy back there in the sound booth, on Thursday morning, our entire sound system died. Nothing. Nothing was coming out of it. No way to fix it. No way. The one critical link in the chain broke, and there was no way to get it back up. And I remember all the team gathered together, and they gathered together to support each other. But I was there to help as well and offer whatever I could. But I had a sense of pride because I understood at this moment, even though the problem seemed like it was above her head, like she didn't know how to fix it, and she didn't know where to start. And you know, there was that sense of panic or being overwhelmed. It was in that process, it was in that place that she girded down, she gathered together, she called the people that she knew, the team came together and supported each other. And in that moment of pressure, of trial, that's that resistance is when her strength or when she came through. And obviously today it sounds great, we're all back to normal because she grew in that moment. You see, it's that resistance in life that we face that brings us to greater places. Peter's an amazing man. Peter was one of Jesus' core disciples. And Peter writes to the churches in the end of the New Testament, 1 Peter in the first chapter. Verse number 6, Peter writes one of those scriptures that we don't really like to read. Why do we not like to read it? Well, let's read it and we'll find out why we don't like to read it. Peter writes in verse number 6 of the first chapter, he says, "In this greatly rejoice, now for a while, if need be, you've been grieved by various trials." You see why I say we don't like to read that? Because nobody wants to rejoice when they're facing resistance. James, the half-brother of Jesus, says the same thing to James. He says, "Brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials." I don't know any person on earth, really, who when they're faced with opposition, when they're faced with resistance, when they feel overwhelmed, when they feel like the pressures of life are going to break them in half, that they're shouting around like, "Woohoo! Praise God! I feel like I'm going to break in half right now. My marriage is falling apart. I can't believe it. God, you're so good." Nobody does that. But yet Peter sheds some light on this. And he says, "Brethren," he says, "rejoice when you're grieved for a little while, if need be, if you're grieved by various trials." Why? And he goes on, he says, why? That the testing of your faith might prove genuine. That your life not be like gold that's burned away by the fire, but that all the chaff and all the waste of your life would be burned away, but you would be revealed. What would be left of you is that faith which would reveal in glory and the revelation of Jesus Christ. So Peter says, listen, there's a refining process that comes to us. And what was so amazing as I was studying this and as I was thinking about this course of this week is what it says in verse number 6, once again, verse number 6 in 1 Peter. It says, "Brethren, rejoice, though for now, for a little while." Look what it says, "if need be." Look what the New English or the English Standard Version says. It says, if necessary, you have been grieved by trials. Think about that for a moment, because life by itself is hard. Life as it is hard. Trying to make ends meet in this world is tough. Trying to just put food on the table is hard work. Trying to keep your family together, trying to raise children that are just good people now on earth, it's a difficult thing to do, just that by itself. That's just life. And he says, listen, he doesn't say, brethren, rejoice because life is tough. That's not what he says. He says, rejoice because if it's necessary in your life, you'll face hardships, trials. It's a refining process. And there's a necessity for each and every one of us in our lives to face resistance so that God can bring us to a new place. Why? Because strength comes by resistance. I love this statement. It makes me so excited to think about this in my own life. And I venture to think that you think the same thing, is the idea that God wants to take you. God wants to take me to a higher place in life. Anybody get in? Can I get an amen from somebody? Which means that where you're at today is not where God wants you to be tomorrow. That where you're at tomorrow is not where God wants you to be. He's going to take you to a higher place in life. God's got plans for you. He's got a purpose for you. He's got something mapped out for you. And he wants you to go to a higher place in life. Man, that just gets me excited. But you know, through all my life of the love of outdoors and finding higher places physically, you know what I found out about higher places? Higher places are always uphill. Ain't nobody ever walked downhill to get to the summit of a mountain. But you see, naturally and spiritually, we want to get to higher places with a downhill effort. And God's going to take you. He wants to take you somewhere greater in life. But if you don't have the stamina, if you don't have the strength, if you don't have the character to maintain the effort and the exertion is going to take to get to a higher place in life and to stay at that place that God has called you, you're not going to make it. So that's why Peter says it's necessary for you and for me to face hardships in our lives. So often we think that as following Jesus makes everything good, just like what we thought getting married makes everything good and all our problems go away. Following Jesus means that I get blessed, and getting blessed, I have no more hard times, and I'm happy every day of my life. Jesus promised that we'd be blessed, but you know what Jesus physically promised? Jesus said, if you want to follow me, here's what I promise. I guarantee you'll get. I guarantee you'll get persecution. I guarantee you'll get hardships. I guarantee you'll get trials. Those were the guarantees out of Jesus, yet people still decide to follow him. Why? Because there's blessing in the midst of that persecution, hardship, and trials. So God wants to take us to a higher place, and it's necessary to bring resistance about us into our lives to create the strength in us to be resilient to what comes at us in life, so that the burdens, as they continue to climb, as the issues and the things that we face continue to happen on a greater scale, that we can be resilient to the weight of the pressure, so that when we feel exhausted, we say, you know what? I still got juice left in me. I'm going to lift my arms. When I feel like I'm going to break, no, I still got strength in my knees, not because of me, like Peter said. The testing happens so that you'd be revealed the glory in Christ. It comes through the power of Christ. You see, it's a call. It's a challenge to you and I to be resilient. But to be resilient to what? To be resilient to the resistance that we'll face in life through the power of Christ. That's the call of Hebrews. Resilience towards resistance comes through the power of Christ. There's somebody in the Bible, my hero, Paul the Apostle. If there's somebody that knew hardships, if there's somebody that learned how to be resilient in life, I think it was Paul the Apostle. As the Bible tells us the story and begins to tell us the story in the book of Acts about Paul, his name at the time was Saul, getting knocked off his horse all the way until the end of his life when his name was Paul, when he changed it to change his identity. I don't think from that moment of Paul's calling to the end of his life, that guy ever had it easy. He talks about being beat. He talks about being caned. He talks about being stoned. He talks about being imprisoned. He talks about being shackled. He talks about being kicked out of towns, being excommunicated by people. Talks about demonic opposition all the days of his life. Paul knew what it was like to face immense pressures. But yet Paul was the living example for you and I beyond Jesus of a human just like us to say, if he can do it, We can too. Paul was the imagery of resilience for you and I, the resilience of the resistance that we face in life through the power of Christ. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians in the fourth chapter. Now, as you're turning there, I'm going to give you some background about it. In 2 Corinthians, Paul talks about the church, and he's talking to the church about his opposition, about his persecution. And in the first chapter, Paul says, listen, guys, I don't want you to be ignorant. I don't want you to be blind to what's been going on in my life. He tells the church, he says, listen, there's been so much problems and so much persecution that I've had that literally I thought I was going to die, that I just wanted to die. I wanted my life to be over. It was just so bad. But he says, I found through the course of this hardship to not rely upon my own self, but to rely on God, on the power of God. Why? And he says, because God delivered us. He does deliver us, and he will continue to deliver us. And so Paul gained this great perspective of resistance in his life and what resistance brings and what it can do for us to propel us and to strengthen us, to bring a sense of resilience to get through the things that this life has to bring on its own, on top of what God wants to do in our lives. And then once again in 2 Corinthians in the fourth chapter, Paul starts to shed some light on his hardships once again. And I really want to just bring out Paul's perspective, his understanding of resistance. And look what Paul says in 2 Corinthians in the fourth chapter, verse number 8. Paul says, we are hard pressed on every side. Think about that for a moment. Paul says, I want you to understand something. There isn't one place in my life I cannot go, or I can go, that I don't face pressure right now. That there's not an avenue anywhere in my life. Everywhere I go, there is immense pressure. But he says, yet I'm not crushed. He says, we're perplexed. We're confused. God, I thought your plan would be like this, but it's not happening like that. God, I thought it was going to turn out like this, but it didn't turn out. I thought these people were going to support me, but then they left me. I don't understand what's going on, but I'm not in despair. Verse number 9, he goes on and he says, I'm persecuted, rejected, disliked by many, but yet I'm not forsaken. I'm not alone in this. I'm struck down, beat up, cast away. Nobody wants to be around me. The devil's trying to take me out, but I have not been destroyed in all of this. You see, Paul had an idea. Paul had an understanding of what he was not, so that he could know who he was. And what happens to us in resistance is we allow what is happening or what has happened to us to define or to describe us. But Paul says, I am not defined. I will not be described by what is happening to me, because that is not who I am. Who I am is resilient. What I am is resilient. I might feel lonely in the holiday season, but I'm not alone because I've got God. I might have people that dislike me, but I am not unloved because I've got God. I might feel like I can't make it in the pressures of life, but I know this is not the end all be all of my life. Why? Because I understand that the pressure, the resistance I'm facing today does not define who I am eternally. But what we do is we have this perception of pain with the desire for comfort, and we allow our perception of pressure to rob us of our potential in Christ. So if anything today, don't let your perception, your acute awareness of how overwhelmed you feel, of your inability to continue on, of your exhaustion in your faith, in your marriage, in your finances, with your children, don't allow your perception or your awareness of the pressure or the resistance that you're facing in life to rob you of the potential that Christ has for you. Because God's got a plan to take you to a higher place, but you got to develop the strength and the stamina to get there. I brought a friend of mine from home to, I think, helps illustrate, paints this picture of God's imagery for Christianity. We call him Crazy Guy. This is Crazy Guy. Maybe you've seen Crazy Guy on the side of the road. I think Crazy Guy is the ultimate imagery of resilience. Paul says, I'm like Crazy Guy. That's what my kids call him. I don't know what he's really called. Crazy Guy. Paul says, I'm getting knocked down. I get pushed over. but I'm not done. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but I keep bouncing back. I feel like I'm alone right now in the holiday season, but I'm not by myself. I don't think I can make it anymore. The world tells me I'm not enough. My family tells me I'm crazy. My bank account says I can't. My kids are going south. Everything is not working out. I don't understand the will of God. I don't understand the purpose of God, but no matter what happens, the resiliency with Christ on the inside of us says, I won't break under the pressure. I won't crack under the pressure. I understand that whatever is pushing me down is bringing me back up. Why? Because I'm resistant. I'm resilient to the resistance of my power, of the power of Christ in me. This is what we are. But unfortunately, far too many of us are like this. I go to church, and the pastor preach a good message, and I'm like, woohoo, praise Jesus. And then Monday comes around. My kids, they start acting good for a day. And then the next day comes around. And far too many of us have this mindset. But Paul says, I have to know what I'm not to know what I am. And I'm not struck down. I'm not alone. I'm not forsaken. I'm not in despair. My story's not over. I'm not finished yet. I can handle this. I can do this. I can make it. I can survive. I can thrive. I can live what God has called me to live. Why? Because I have resilience to the resistance in my life through the power of Christ. I understand that resistance comes to me in the form of hardships, but it also comes in the form of God. Why? To build the character to take me to a higher place in life. And Paul even says this in 2 Corinthians in the 4th chapter, verse number 10, as he continues that thought. He says, look, I'm always carrying the death of Jesus or the dying of Jesus in my life so that the life of Jesus might be manifested in our body. Verse number 11, he says it again, repeats himself. We who believe are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake that his life might also be manifested in our mortal flesh. You know what manifested means? Sometimes I think manifested is this like ultra spiritual term, right? Like they're manifesting. There's some manifestations over there. That kid having a temper tantrum. Ooh, he manifesting right now. You know what manifested means? Manifested means revealed, made known. Paul says, I'm carrying the death of Jesus in my body that the life of Jesus might be made known to the world. That the hardships, the trials, the pressures in life that I face are always happening to me and the people that believe. Why? So that they would look at me and they would look at you and the way we are resilient to the pressures of life and it would be made known that there's something different about us. Why? Because your resiliency is not based on your tenacity. It's based on the power of Christ through you. We're resilient through the power of Christ on the inside of us. It's God's plan for us, the church. Listen, you and I, we are the revelation of God's divine will to humanity on earth. That's why we're like a lighthouse amidst the storm, standing strong when the waves blow and the wind blows. Why? Because the world will see the resiliency of the church and begin to say, there's something, the church, that you have that I don't have, and I can't make it any longer on my own. I've tried. And I feel like giving up. And you can say you don't have to give up because there's something greater for you. God's got a greater plan. And all you got to do is lean in on the power of Jesus to get through it. And that's why I think Paul says one of the most famous verses in the New Testament, aside from John 3:16, is Philippians 4:13. Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Listen, you might feel downcast, but you're not out. You might feel alone, but you're not alone. You might feel like nobody cares about you, but somebody cares about you. You might feel like you're worthless, but you're priceless. You see, you got to understand what you're not to understand what you are. Don't let your perception of the pressures and resistance in your life today rob you from the potential that Christ has. Why? Because God wants to take you to a higher place. God wants to take you to a higher place. God wants to use you to shine His glory, to the world. God wants to do something great in your life, and it's gonna take resiliency to get through it. Did anybody get something out of God's word today? Amen. Amen. I'll tell you what. You walk out of this place in Thanksgiving, you walk out of this place for, you might be facing those family members or whatever it might be. Hey, guess what? You could be resilient. You can make it. You can do this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, listen, before we leave, before we finish, before the mass exodus takes place, let me just take a moment and ask you to just think about some things for a moment. Just be honest, be open, be transparent with yourself. Nobody knows you better than you except God. And I just want you to take a moment and think about your life for a moment. Talking about opposition, talk about feeling overwhelmed, talking about feeling like you can't make it anymore. So often we go through so much of life alone, carrying burdens and weights that we don't need to carry because we're doing it alone. And you see, you don't have to live life alone. Your resiliency to the resistance of your life does not come because of your tenacity. It comes because of your relationship with Jesus Christ. And today there are some of you in this place that I believe you've been carrying weights all of your life. You've been carrying the burdens of what's happened to you, what's been happening to you, or what might happen to you. You've been carrying this weight all by yourself. Listen, God doesn't want you to carry that weight. Jesus says, come to me, all who are heavy laden, take my yoke upon you. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. I'll help you. You see, that doesn't come by attending church. That doesn't come by good thoughts. That doesn't come by a sense of religion or works. See, the only way that we can come and be a part of the life that Jesus Christ has promised to us is by accepting him into our lives. You see, Paul the Apostle tells us in Romans that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. He goes on and he says, but the free gift of God, the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. See, each and every one of us has an inherent nature on the inside of us, an inherent sense of sin. Nobody had to teach you how to lie when you were a kid. Nobody had to teach you how to cheat on that test in school. Nobody had to teach you how to steal cookies from the cookie jar when mom wasn't looking. You figured that out all on your own. Why? Because there's an inherent sense of sin on the inside of humanity. The Bible tells us, Paul tells us that our sin nature brought us to a place of being window shoppers. On the outside looking in. Looking at somebody else saying, how come I don't have a life like that? How come I'm not resilient like that? How come things aren't going my way like it is theirs? And Jesus says these words in John the 3rd chapter. Jesus says, in order to inherit the kingdom of God. What is an inheritance? An inheritance is an inclusive term. An inheritance belongs to people who are on the inside, not on the outside. In order to be on the inside and not on the outside looking in, he says, in order to be a part of the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. Born again is not what Hollywood and society and cultures made it out to be, weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. That's not born again. Born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible in the heart and the eyes of God is this. It's a relationship, an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. See, God's not after your outward works. He's not after your good deeds. He's not after your church attendance or your religious sense. He's not after your spirituality or your heightened sense of spirituality. He's not after your thoughts. You know, I hope I'm good or I think I'm good. God's after your heart. And he did everything he could to ensure that you and I have a position in his kingdom for eternity and life here on earth by sending Jesus Christ to become sin for us, that he would take our place. And in return, he asks that we would accept him, that we would receive him, that we would take him in to our hearts and to our lives, an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. And today I want to give you the opportunity for those of you in this place. Maybe you've been living your life wondering. Maybe you've been living your life asking. Maybe you've been living your life thinking or hoping. Maybe you've been living your life not knowing. Maybe you've been living your life not even doing. Today I want to give you the opportunity in just a moment to receive that gift of salvation today. So just a moment, what we're going to do is I'll count to three. I'll go like this. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. I'll smack my hands together. I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'll ask you to do something real bold together. We'll do it all at the same time. I'm ask you to pop your hand up and see what you're doing by the raising of your hand. You're just saying, you know what, today I want to give my heart. I'll do it in just a moment, you guys. I see you. I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus. I'm tired of doing things on my own. I'm tired of carrying my weight on my own. See, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge you. Put it right back down. See, what you're doing, what we'll do in just a moment is we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together, to invite Jesus to be part of your life. And what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, you know what, that's me. I want to pray that prayer. I want to do something. I want to give my life to Jesus today. I want to give my life to God. I'm tired of carrying this weight on my own. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. Here's what we're going to do in just a moment. I'm going to do that. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do just for a moment. I want you to just take a quick moment to examine your heart, to examine your life. And I want you just to do this for me. Would you just close your eyes, bow your head just for a moment? Not out of embarrassment, not out of shame, but just to examine, to shut out everything that's going on around you, to shut out all the different thoughts, and look into your heart and look into your life and look into your soul. Where is it that you stand with God? If you were to die today, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Are you right with God? Say, man, I hope so. I want to. Or maybe. I think so. Did you know that the Bible tells us in Acts that God came to turn on the lights so that we don't have to walk around in the darkness hoping that we're right with God? Just because you think so because you hope so doesn't mean that you're going to make it. Well, you know what? I've been doing some church things, and I've been doing a little bit of this, and I went to church every once in a while. You know, Jesus says in Revelation, I'd rather find that you're hot or cold, because if you're lukewarm somewhere in the middle, he says, I'll vomit you, reject you out of my mouth or my kingdom. Today, if you've been playing games, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, if you've been playing the church game and you know it, listen, today this is the time for you to accept that invitation of Jesus into your heart and your life. In that same statement about hot and cold, Jesus says this to his church. He says, listen, I stand at the door and I knock. He says, if you just open up your heart, if you'd open up your life, he says, I come in and we'll have a relationship together. I believe right now all across this auditorium, the Spirit of God is knocking on your heart, saying it's time for you to stop doing life your way. It's time for you to stop carrying the pressures and the burdens your way. It's time to give your heart, it's time to give your life to Jesus Christ with an all or nothing relationship. To surrender everything to God today through his son, Jesus. If you're not sure today, make sure. If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus today, this is the day of your salvation. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, today it's your day to go forward for God and all that he has for you. In just a moment, I'm going to count to three, and if that's you, you pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. I'm going to call you up, and we'll pray together a prayer of salvation. Your life will change today, and what you're saying is, Pastor, I want you to include me in that prayer today. I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it, put it right back down. I've already seen a couple of hands. I'm going to count to three right now. If that's you in this place, you pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, you put it right back down. All across this auditorium. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place. I see you. I see you. I see you. I see those hands. I see those hands back in the back. No, don't clap yet. I see you back over there. That's you in this place today. Pop your hand up so I can see it. Anybody else? I see you back over there in the back. I got you. I see the ushers pointing to somebody back over there. All right, I see you over there. I got you, my man, back in the back. That's you over here. Anybody else in this place? You say, man, I wonder if that's me. The Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. It's time for you to respond to the invitation of Jesus in your heart and into your life, to accept and to receive life. Anybody else in this place? About 10 wise people, anybody else today? Saying, Pastor, I want you to include me in that prayer. Anybody else? I see you guys right here. Awesome. Praise God. I see you right in the middle. Anybody else today? Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Amen. Hands all over the place. Now, for those of you that raised your hands, maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you feel that those butterflies, that calling, there's something just pulling you. If that's you in this place today, we're going to pray a prayer together, and I want to pray with you. So I'm going to ask you to do something bold. I'm going to ask you to do something great. I'm going to ask you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair. We're all going to stand in just a moment. And when we do, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your sweater, your coat, your purse, your friend, a Bible, a friend if you need a friend, family members, whoever it might be, to get out of your seat, get in the aisle, and come meet me right here. I want to shake your hand, and I want to pray with you today. We're all going to stand together. Please, nobody leave. If you raise your hand and you want to pray that prayer, come on. Come and meet me up here. Let's change destinies together right here, right now. Everything's going to change, but it starts now. That's you. You can come. This is your moment. My righteousness, oh hey. God, how I need. Right on. Looking sharp. Congratulations. Awesome. Lord, I need. Great job. Oh, I need. That's you. Come on. Hey, guys. Hey, lay it on me. Give me a high five. Give me a high five. Man, look at that watch. That's awesome. If that's you, you come. This is your moment. My amen. That's some cool hair. Bless you. Hey, you guys came and they're still coming. Come on. It's not too late. Awesome. Hey, I want to tell you something. I want you to know something, okay? Jesus tells this story. He talks about the story. He says, there's a shepherd. And it's a parable. It's a story, okay? He says, there's a shepherd who has 100 sheep. And he says, and one of those sheep goes and gets lost in the dark forest. I'm paraphrasing it. He says, what is that shepherd going to do? He's going to go after that one sheep and leave the 99 good ones. And he's going to take that one sheep and he's going to put it over his shoulder and he's going to carry it back to all the good ones. And he's going to say, hey, everybody I know. He's going to call up everybody I know. He says, come and celebrate with me because what was once lost is now found. What was once out is now restored. And you know what? He's not talking about sheep. He's talking about you. And he's talking about me. And he says that all of heaven has a party when just one lost comes back to Jesus. So listen, you might have a lifetime full of mistakes, but let me be the first person to tell you today, good job. Good job. Doing a good job. Responding to the invitation of God. There's nothing better you could be doing. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray a prayer together, okay? I'm going to ask you just to repeat some words after me, but I want you to understand. God doesn't listen just to the words of your mouth like it's an abracadabra magical prayer. You say it the right way, you don't miss any words, and everything's good. He listens to the prayers of your hearts. So I'm going to lead you in some words, but I just want you to believe what we're saying with your heart. Use your mouth to say it, repeat it after me. And let's go before the Lord and let's pray together. And all the people out there today, would you join with me today? And let's all pray this together. If you're watching online and you want to give your heart to Jesus, you can pray this prayer as well. But let's all join together. Let's all close our eyes and bow our heads today. And let's go before the Lord in prayer. And repeat these words after me today. Father God, I come to you today. And I acknowledge that I need you. I commit my life to Jesus Christ. I ask that you forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me of my past. I make the decision to give my future to you. From this day forward, I'm going to follow Jesus with all of my heart and with all of my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. I'm a Christian headed for heaven, leaving hell behind in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, just that easy. Great job. Really quickly, here's what I want to do. You see this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel just wants to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. Here's what he wants to do. He wants to introduce you to a friend, somebody that will pray with you today if you need some prayer. They'll get some information, some literature into your hands to help get you strong and set you in the right way. We even got comic books for you guys, all right? Something cool to read. Just help point you in the right direction. And he's going to invite you to come back and meet with somebody to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you. So if you would, just turn to your left, my right, right over here with Pastor Joel. Thank you.